Good morning, everyone, and welcome to another virtual broadcast brought to you by Spirit of God Christian Church. We are so excited and thankful for another service to be able to bring the Word of God to you virtually each week and to those who continuously tune in and support the ministry. If it's your first time tuning in, welcome. We hope you enjoy today's service and continue to join us each week. Stay tuned because we have an exciting service planned for you this morning, beginning with corporate prayer, worship and song, and a word from our pastor, Pastor Randall Knighton.
Good morning and welcome to Spirit of God Christian Church and Corporate Prayer. I'm Deacon Ed Jeffrey, and today we're going to jump straight into the Word of God and what it costs to follow Jesus. We're going to take a look at the book of Luke, chapter 9, verses 57 through 62. We're going to break them down a little bit here, but before we start, I want someone to say out there, put me in, coach. Let me hear you say, put me in, coach. You see, let me set the stage for what was going on here. Jesus had already predicted his death a second time. And now he's on his way to Jerusalem to fulfill his purpose here in the earth. And on the way, this is where we pick up. As they were walking along the road, a man said to him, I will follow you wherever you go. Somebody say, put me in, coach. Jesus replied, foxes have dens and birds have nests, but the Son of Man has no place to lay his head. You see, Jesus wasn't saying that he was tired and he needed to lay his head down. What he was telling the man is that we about the business here. Time is short and there is no time to rest. Right? Amen? Let's take a look at the next verse. He said to another man, follow me. But he replied, Lord, first let me go and bury my father. Jesus said to him, let the dead bury their own dead, meaning let the unbelievers bury their own dead, but you, a believer, go and proclaim the kingdom of God. Hallelujah. Let's look at the last set of verses here. Verses 61 and 62. Still another said, I will follow you, Lord. Somebody say, put me in, coach. But first, let me go back and say goodbye to my family. Jesus replied, no one who puts a hand to the plow and looks back is fit for service in the kingdom of God. You see, what he was saying is that you can't have one foot in the world and one foot in the kingdom. You can't be tied to this world and follow me. Jesus said that if you want to be a disciple, you must first deny yourself and pick and take up your cross daily and follow him. Amen. You see, everybody is willing and wanting to be on a winning team. Team Jesus. Until it's time. Until your name is called. You want to be on the winning team, but you don't want to do necessarily what it takes to stay on the winning team. Amen. God took me back to my high school years, my junior year. We had just finished our football season at 6-3. We didn't make the playoffs, we didn't go to state, but we knew the following year we were gonna be undefeated. If not just one loss, we were gonna go to state. Hype was all over the high school, but by the time practice started the following year, we started to see people on the team who was in high school with us, but never been on football before. You know us in high school, what are you doing out here, man? They said, well, I want to be on the team. You see, they wanted their picture in the book. They wanted their name written in the book. How many know what I'm talking about? Well, we get through practice and all of a sudden we start getting to these what we call two-a-days. You work out first in the morning, then you go home and rest and you come back and you work out another couple more hours. And the next thing you know, these people who wanted to be on the team started disappearing left and right. You see, they didn't take into account what it would really take to be on a winning team. And we as believers need to know that when we say, put me in, coach, we have to know what it's going to take when our name is called. Amen? I'm going to say this and then we'll pray. When you think about football teams, pro football, the starter quarterbacks and the backup quarterbacks. The backup quarterback isn't just sitting on the bench when warm-ups are taking place before the game starts and he says, hey guys, I'm good over here. If you need me, give me a call. No. You see, that backup quarterback is going through the same motions as the starting quarterback. First string, throwing, calisthenics, warming up, getting hyped up in case the coach looks down the bench and says, Jeffrey, get in there. What are we doing in preparation while we're on the bench? Are we just sitting there saying, hey, I'm glad to be on Team Jesus? Or are we preparing ourselves for that day when Jesus calls our name and says, hey, I need you to minister to this person. I need you to witness to this person. I need you to give service to this church. What are we doing when Jesus calls upon our name and says, I'm calling you to minister? We need to be prepared, church. Spirit of God Christian Church, and all of you believers that are looking in today, we're on the move, man. There's no time to waste. We're not stopping. We're not going to rest. We're going to keep powering through into the kingdom of heaven. Amen? With that said, let's bow our heads in prayer. Lord, we thank you this day. We thank you this day that you woke us up, Almighty God. We thank you that you can still look down the bench and see us sitting, waiting for our name to be called, Almighty God. We thank you for allowing us to be on Team Jesus. We ask by your mighty hand today, dear Lord, through the word that you shared with us, that you give us the desire in our hearts, the strength in our minds, in our spirits, the time in our daily lives to take up our own cross, dear Lord, and to follow you, to prepare ourselves for battle. It's not if, Almighty God, but it's when, because there is a battle. And we thank you, Almighty God, that you've chosen us. Lord, it didn't say that we had to be perfect to follow you. But we do need to be prepared. We thank you, Lord, that you woke us up and we are breathing today, that we can take up our cross, as said, dear Lord, and just follow you. Show us the way, dear Father God. Place us in positions, as we mentioned last week, like pieces on a chessboard, dear Father God. Just use us for your glory and for your will. We thank you, Lord, for Spirit of God Christian Church, that we have so many believers that are in the mode of being put in, dear Father God. Build us up, Lord. Touch the hearts of those individuals who are wanting to draw closer to you, wanting to be of service to you in your kingdom. We thank you for Spirit of God Christian Church and the building that is being built, Lord, to draw all those closer to you, Lord. We ask right now in the name of Jesus that you touch the hearts of so many around Metro Atlanta, Lord, and draw them to your church at Spirit of God Christian Church, Lord. Continue to bless each and every person in their hands, the works of their hands in the church, in the building of the church, Lord. And we just ask that you continue to bless our pastor and our First Lady, as they tirelessly put together the perfect plan that you've placed in their spirits, Lord. We bless your mighty name today, and we look forward to worship and the word. And it's in the mighty name of Jesus. All the believers said amen, amen, and amen. Put me in, coach.
Just say yes, you'll lead the way. I'm not afraid of what it means for me to say that this life you gave is not my own. Trusting you to hear my yes and lead me home. Yeah.
I'll just say yes. Put me in, coach. My life is not my own. I'll just say yes. I might not see it now, but God, I know that you'll save the best. God, I have peace when I say yes. When I say yes, God, I know that you're going to respond. No more delay. Because, God, when you say yes, it happens. When you said, let there be, there was. And, God, I just say yes. I'm ready, God, for whatever it is you have for me. Whatever it is, God, take my life. I'll just say yes. My life isn't mine. It's yours, God. My life, my living, my lips say yes. Yes, Lord. Yes. Amen, amen, amen. Good morning. I'm Pastor Randall Knighton, Pastor of Spirit of God Christian Church. It is a privilege. It is a pleasure. It is an honor to come to you today in the only, the true and living God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. One God. Amen. Just like you would see one triangle expressed in three equal sides. In each dimension, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. But yet still one God in unison. Let us make man. It says, amen. Amen and amen. I'm just grateful and excited this morning. I believe it's a great word today. It's just so encouraging. I want to thank everybody from last week for in-person service. And again, just, you know, I had a different message on in-person, and I did record the audio. If somebody wanted to just reach out to info@spiritofgodcc.org, I'll get it to you. I can't promise you it's the standard of the media team quality. But I certainly will send it to you if you want it. But more importantly, and then the message last week online was a blessing as well. So if you missed that, go ahead and listen to that as it was a continuation from the week prior. I want to thank Deacon Ed this morning. I want to thank the music ministry this morning as everybody is in tune, in step, right, and in touch with the Holy Spirit as we are right in line. Deacon Ed, that was magnificent. If you missed corporate prayer this morning, I'm telling you, you please go back and listen to that. Some of his real life analogies, real life experience in this situation, in what God had given to him for us, and just really breaking down that scripture was a blessing this morning. And of course, the music ministry, CC always does such a marvelous job, you know, just with the music ministry and handling things. And if you missed in-person service on first Sunday, on July the 2nd, CC ended up doing, you know, was our single. Our sole praise and worship leader that day is, you know, a lot of people were traveling, a lot of praise team members were traveling, but she handled it magnificently. I mean, magnificently. And I just praise God for her and her commitment. Just a couple of quick housekeeping issues I want to share with you today. We'll be back in-person service, as I said last week. Again, I appreciate a church that understands the vision. And our vision is that we're going to meet first and second Sunday because that's what the Lord says we're to do. And we're to take the other Sundays rather than we thank God for the Doubletree. God knows we do. And we pray God's blessings upon that place. But again, on those other Sundays, we're taking that money and putting it at 1200 Upper Henry Road so that we can build what the Lord has laid out for us. And it is coming fast and in a hurry. And we thank God for all that he is doing and how he's doing that in that process. And again, I'll continue to try to keep you updated as we are dealing with some things right now, having to kind of go back and forth with the city on some things and just preparation. So just stay tuned as we continue to move forward. But the Lord's going to have some great news on that, hopefully in the next month or so. Also, Bible study will return back this Thursday. We'll pick back up in Revelation chapter 19 and go from there. And I just encourage you, if you missed Bible study, I know I took last week to do some ministry stuff, but if you missed Bible study, go ahead and go back and listen to the Bible studies that are there. Also want to thank everybody who did come out, who's already contributed, whether it be online or in person, for the Back to School Mission Project. And we're even dropped off at the land this week as well. This is one more week that we'll have for drop off out at the church property, 1200 Upper Henry Road. And you can go to Church's app and website and find out the items and details that are needed. And really, we try to stay true to the list of what they've asked. But if you have other school supplies as well, you know, we're going to accept them. And I'm sure that they'll put them to good use as well. And again, we just want to do our piece as our children prepare to go back to school. Amen. Amen. And amen. And then I have one of the great announcements that I always like to have is when I get a new member. Amen. From a family of faithful members, a Payne family, welcomed on Thursday, July the 6th. John Franklin Payne. Don't that sound like a name with great authority, or a name with a great destiny, a name that's going to change things, very distinguished, just like his parents, Michael and Tamika Payne. Payne family has been members of Spirit of God for a very, very long time. And again, we thank God enough for this handsome young man, this handsome boy that was born to the Payne family, John Franklin Payne. Amen. I like saying his name. But I'm grateful that God has blessed us and blessed the Payne family with another member here at Spirit of God Christian Church, and the Payne family with another member to their wonderful growing family, as they are such great people, such great members, and such great Christians in what they do. And I know that they're going to raise John as they have with their other kids, in the nurture and the admonition of the Lord. So congratulations to the Payne family and to you, Spirit of God, for adding another member. Amen. Amen. And amen. All right. I want to get into the word now. For today, I'm going to read you a scripture. I'm going to talk to you a little bit, and I'm going to give you some points and some guidance, or some direction, or some pointers. You know, one thing about a journey is you need sometimes those tent poles. You need those mile markers, if you will, along the way. And just as a reminder of what God is doing and what God was going to bring to pass. So that's what we're going to look at today. And I just pray that you are encouraged by this. I want you to see my shirt. Yes, this is one of my favorite sayings. First person I ever heard say it was Lady Joyce Madison, that God's will is his bill. And I thank the God is Love brand for making this shirt for me a few years ago and adding their own creative touch of paid in full. Amen. Amen. When you in God's will, the bill is paid in full. Amen. And so I want you to see that today from somebody who's had some issues, like many of us. Amen. Had some sins in their life, but God still, when they got into the will of God, I feel like preaching already. When they got into the will of God, what they found out was that God would pay the bill as long as I stayed in his will. Amen. Yes, I got a past. And we talked about that a little bit last week in person. Yeah, I got a past. I might have been that. But guess what? But because of Jesus Christ, I'm more than that. And we're going to see that today in somebody as well. Genesis chapter 28, verse 10 through 17. Then I'm going to concentrate and highlight on one verse in particular. Jake, in verse 10, Jacob left Beersheba and set out for Haran. When he reached a certain place, he stopped for the night because the sun had set. Taking one of the stones there, he put it under his head and lay down to sleep. He had a dream in which he saw a stairway resting on the earth with its top reaching to heaven, and the angels of God were ascending and descending on it. Now, this is where we get Jacob's ladder. I know in the King James it says a ladder, but nevertheless, nothing lost in the translation here. What I want you to see with Jacob very simply is what Jacob is seeing is the communication and the communion with God, that the angels are descending and ascending, that he is showing the connection, right, of heaven touching earth, as one of our songs would say, amen. And that's what's happening, is that God is reaching down and letting him know and letting us know that I have a communion and a communication system by which you can reach and touch me in that sense, and that I can reach and get communication to you. All right. So let's keep going. Verse 13, there above it stood the Lord, right? And he said, I am the Lord, the God of your father Abraham, the God of Isaac. I will give you your descendants the land on which you are, give you and your descendants the land on which you are lying. Right? So where you're laying at, right? He says, what I'm saying, he's saying, listen, this is who I am. I'm the God of Abraham and Isaac. That's what he's telling Jacob. And he said, the promises that I made to Abraham and Isaac. He said, I'm going to give you the land on which you're lying on. Why? Because I made those promises to them. He's letting him know. And so as I've even said, you know, a lot of us living off the promises that God made to mama and daddy, that God made to grandmama and granddaddy, God to listen to some of our siblings that God made when some folk were laying and tarrying and praying for you. God made some promises to them because of their faithfulness to him. Amen. We ought to just walk in those with great authority. Verse 14, your descendants. Now, this sounds just like the promise he made to Abraham and Isaac, right? Your descendants will be like the dust of the earth, and you will spread out to the west and to the east, to the north and to the south. All peoples on the earth will be blessed through you and your offspring. I am with you and will watch over you wherever you go, and I will bring you back to this land. I will not leave you until I have done what I have promised. When Jacob awoke from his sleep, he thought, surely the Lord is in this place, and I was not aware of it, but God made him aware of it because he had an encounter. Amen. God does speak to us in so many different ways, and one of the ways is through dreams. Not every dream is from God. Not every dream is a communication from God, but there are certainly dreams that are communications from God. Verse 17, he was afraid and said, how awesome is this place? This is none other than the house of God. This is the gate of heaven. Amen. Because he saw the ladder, because he understood and saw the angels ascending and descending. And when he saw and he looked up at the top of it, there he was. There was God Jehovah. There he was, Yahweh, the one who was, who is, and will always be, was standing there and giving him, amen, the promise that he had given to Abraham and Isaac, that he was passing it on unto him. I want to concentrate in verse 15, though, today. I am, that's the I am with you and will watch over you wherever you go, and I will bring you back to this land. I will not leave you until I've done what I have promised you. He told Jacob, the place you lying, that's where you and your descendants and all the people of the earth is going to be blessed through you. That's the promise I made to Abraham. It's the promise I made to Isaac. And now I'm making it to you. Amen. So I'm going to talk to you today from these words. I'm going to try to stay calm in this, but I still got to give you my passion a little bit. But here's the thing about this, because I really want us to see this. Stay ready for what God promised you. Stay ready for what God promised you. Now, Spirit of God Christian Church, we know that in this year, 2023, we're in a year of increase by way of decrease. And so one of the things I want us to make sure that we understand and know is that God is still working this out. We know what God has promised. We know what God's going to bring to pass, but we need to continue to stay ready. That's why I loved Deacon Ed's corporate prayer this morning, because his corporate prayer very simply was about put me in, coach. In other words, and I love his analogy of his high school team, because he knew that they were getting ready to have a great season that senior year. And so everybody then wanted to be a part of it, but everybody didn't want to make the commitment. Preach, boy, that all, preach Deacon Ed. Yeah, absolutely. And so what happens is the two-a-days, some of the things, the commitments, some of the requirements, people start to fall off. Can I preach just a little bit? Listen, I don't throw in no shade at nobody. I'm just telling you what is. I understand that the commitment of the season that we're in, everybody can't handle it. But what God has shown is that those who are faithful, God is going to bring to pass still what he promised the Spirit of God Christian Church. That's why I get on here and I thank all of you for staying connected, for staying committed to the vision that God has in this house. Because guess what? The two-a-days or the two Sundays a month haven't really worn you out and taken you away from Spirit of God, because you're still right here. I just thank God that as we go through this season that has been difficult, it has been hard, but you have stayed the course, because guess what? Not so you can hoist the trophy, but because your commitment to God and your belief in God, and you're letting God know, I'm ready for what you promised. I want to share this with you. I've watched many of you. Let me just say this first. I watched many of my members go through some great promotions in their life. Great things have happened in their life in ways some were not expected. Some didn't know how God was going to do it. But as I said, even last week about a member who right now is in the hospital, or a former member who's in the hospital. But I saw this last week or two in real time, a culmination from one of my members. And just in this very piece here of just her staying ready for what God had promised her. That over the years that as she had prepared herself, going back to school, getting her degree, doing some of these things, working hard, being a faithful employee, doing her job with kingdom quality and excellence. But there were promotional opportunities that were coming. But the one thing she was consistent in is that, no, I must have God's will. I want God's perfect will. I don't want his passive will. I don't want his permissive will. I want God's perfect will. Now, she was patient, and in God's patient will, he kept her. And we're going to talk about that a little bit today. But what happened was in the culmination, that's why I loved even the song today, that when God says yes, and I have peace, God, when you say yes, that there's now no longer any delay. Because when God says now is the time, then that time then has to take place, and it begins to happen rapidly. It begins to happen wonderfully. Everything begins to fall in place, and we've experienced that too, even with some of the lending institutions trying to get this building done. But now God has said, now is the time, and things are beginning to fall into place. But I saw this member wait patiently on God. Yes, I'm sure there were days she would tell you, yes, I might have doubted myself, yes, but I knew what God had, and continued to stay ready, continued to prepare herself for the moment. And guess what? When God did it over this past week, 10 days, 2 weeks, what God did was God gave her an increase. We in a year increase by way of decrease, gave her an increase, and then God made the move on top of it. But the increase needed to come before, so that the move would not be a setback or a decrease, but just a straight increase. The decrease had already happened, and God said, now it's time for increase. I just want you to know that you and I need to stay ready for what God has promised us. I know some of us are right now, and don't you think I am with a pastor who is trying to build a church. Don't you think that I'm just feeling like at times I'm on a treadmill. But you know what the beauty of that old treadmill is? It will get you in shape and endurance. It will build up your endurance and your wind for the race that is before you. You will be in shape so that when you get off, you can go and do what God has called you to do. Yes, absolutely. I would have much rather have had this happen sooner rather than later, but I wouldn't have been in his will. Therefore, it wouldn't have been his bill. We've waited on God. We've waited on his time, and we've stayed ready. We've continued to study his word. We've continued to pray and be faithful as a people. We continue to trust God. We've continued to try to help those in need. We've continued to do what God has said that we are to do, because we just staying ready for what he promised us. If I can encourage you today, I just want you to keep doing things with kingdom quality, kingdom excellence, and watch God bring forth the increase. Watch God bring forth the promotion, and then watch God make the move that is necessary, because God will increase you, because the move will require more. God will raise up and God will promote, so because the next thing is going to require something different. It's at a different level. But when God sees your faithfulness, how can I go to the word? If you've been faithful over a few things, God will make you ruler over many things. If you've been faithful as an employee, God will elevate you to be a manager or a director. If you've been faithful, amen, of pastoring a few, God will increase the opportunity for you to reach others for the sake of the kingdom, not for the sake of your name or your brand. We got to stay in his will. And let me say this. The reason why I say this, say, preacher, you ain't gave me no scripture yet. Yes, I did. I gave you Genesis 28:15. I told you I was going to concentrate there. But let me say this to you. Here's what I know. Jacob was leaving home because he had tricked Esau out of his blessing. Here's the thing about it. I want you to understand something. But God had plans still for Jacob. Jacob was a supplanter, a trickster, a con man, if you will. But here he was now on a journey. And on that journey, as he's running from, headed to a place that with Laban that was going to be safe for him, he had to come and have an experience and an encounter. It was necessary for him to have this encounter where he saw the true and living God. But the reason why it was necessary, because God needed to let him know I'm real. He had to let him know that which I promised, I'm passing on to you, and I'm promising it to you. Not because you're worthy, not because you deserve it, but because I said it. Amen. My parents were, because I said so, parents, and I love them for it. Which means then that when the parents laid down the law, it was what it was. No explanation needed. But at times, later on, I might find out why it was that they did it. And there were some things that they were preparing in me for real life and real world. That's why, just because they said so. Amen. Many people back up and buck up it because I said so. But you don't need to do that with God. Because when God says so, because you've been blessed, can I preach just a little bit? See, when God has said so and you can get blessings, Everybody's good with that because God said so and kept the enemy back from you. Because God, when Satan asked to sift you as wheat, he said, no, you can't have him. Why? Because I said so. Satan said, but he ain't been faithful. He's been a con man. He's been a trickster because I said so. Because I said so to Abraham. Because I said so to Isaac. And now I said so to Jacob, it has to be. But because I said so to grandmama, because I said so to granddaddy, because I said so to your parents. Uh-huh. Amen. Yeah, it's got to be. But here's our role. We got to stay in God's will by staying ready for what God has promised. Amen. 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 Let me give you this way. I'm going to just give you a few points, but I got to look at this. On your journey to what God promised you, stay ready to experience some things with God. I just need for you to know, you may be somewhere in here, but I just need for you to know that God hadn't forgotten about you, because God's will is his bill. And every promise of God, God's will is his bill. We know that God has made great promises, but we want to look at, and I just want to concentrate today on the one he made to Jacob. Yes, I know God has promised to provide. I'm just going to give you just something here I want you to think about. God has promised to provide. He said, you know, the Apostle Paul would tell us in Philippians, very simply, it is, for my God shall supply all your needs according to his riches in glory by Christ Jesus. He promised provision. He promised that everything, he didn't promise everything would be good, but it would work out for our good, right? And we know that all things work together for good to them that love God, to them who are called according to his purpose. That's his promise. He promised in Isaiah, he said, look, I'm going to go before you, right? He promised even Abraham, anybody that comes against you, I'm going to come against them. Anybody that blesses you, I'm going to bless them. Anybody that curses you, I'm going to curse them, right? He promised Joshua, every place the sole of your foot touches, I've given you this land. He promised Jacob, the land you're lying on right now is yours. So we know God has got promises all over the place, but we need to hold to those. But part of the issue is we're not ready for the promise. We don't have kingdom excellence in our life. We don't operate in kingdom quality. We haven't been faithful. We haven't been truthful, right? We've been operating in some sins that we don't want to drop. We need to stay ready. Part of the problem is God said, if I came to you, you'd be getting ready. Versus staying ready. Amen. Amen. Come on now. On your journey to what God promised you, stay ready to experience God's first, his presence, to know it. Oh, yeah. Oh, it's beautiful. Amen. Listen, here's the thing. You ain't gonna walk with God and not come to know his presence. Amen. Not to come, not only to not feel it, but to know it. To experience, to see it at work, to see and know, to know that he is with you. Don't you know that that's what he did with Jacob? That's why when he looked up, he got his attention with the ladder. He got his attention. But then when he looked up at the top of it, there he was standing there, as the Bible says. And so he got his attention because he wanted him to know my presence is with you. And then in the promise verse of 15, he says right at the very beginning, right? Even in the first part of the A clause, he says, I am with you. I am with you. That's what he says. In other words, my presence is going to be with you. And I want you to break that down just a little bit to I am is with me. When he told Moses, he said, you go and tell Pharaoh I am sent you. That means I am. That means anything that I need, I am will do it for me. I am the beginning and the end. I am Alpha and Omega. I am the one who was, who is, and will always be. I am with you. So what God is sending me to tell you today is, I don't care what you're dealing with, is that I am is with you. Oh, isn't that a great promise? That's a promise from the God who never lies. That's the one who says, and it has to be. That's the one who utters it, and it comes into existence. He is the only one who can speak things into existence, because even the Bible tells us, who can speak and have it happen if the Lord has not willed it? But the Lord has already willed it when he speaks it from his mouth. So when he says, I am with you, he means I am with you. I know you've seen some dark days. I know we've messed it up with sin sometimes. I know we might be on the run from our past. But God is saying this encounter today is so that you can stay ready for what I promised you. And I need you to know that I promised you I'm with you. Yeah, I know you might even be going through the consequences. Jacob was going through the consequences of his sin. Consequences of his trickery. But he laid down and rested. And as he laid down and rested, He got into what happened was God tapped him in that dream and let him know his presence. You know, sometimes you got to just know his presence. God will touch you to let you feel and let you know his presence is with you. And then look at what he did in it all. I mean, my goodness. In it all, he gives him a word for his life. But one thing he gives him is, I am with you. And God knows, I want you to know it. And today I need for you to know that he is with you. He's with you even when others are coming against you, but I'm with you. Even when others don't appreciate you, I'm with you. Even when others don't say thank you, I'm with you. Even when others get on your last nerve and you just tired, sick and tired of being sick and tired. He says, but I am with you. When you feel alone and lonely, he says, I just need for you to know I am with you. Amen. That's why you need to stay ready for the promise of God. Amen. The thing that God promised you, that in that time, I promise you, my member and my members who've gone through this, in this year of increase by way of decrease, I've had to remind myself, they've had to remind themselves what God promised and that he's with me. This I know. Amen. Amen. Let's keep going on your journey to what God promised you. Stay ready to not only experience God's presence, to come to know it, but to experience God's protection. Amen. See, there's a lot in this scripture. In just that one verse, there's a lot in the account of Jacob. And yes, I talked a little bit in person about how he changed his name. That's afterwards. This is even before he gets to Laban. This is in the throes of Jacob coming to himself, if you will, coming to the realization that I've done what I've done, and now I'm on the run. But the Lord has promised me that he's with me. He didn't condone what I did, but the promise he made, I'm still going to benefit from because he's a good God that way. Now, Jacob had to deal with his consequences. Please understand that. But the one thing he had in his consequences, because of this encounter and because of his journey and because of the promise of God, was that God was going to be with him and God was going to protect him. In other words, in his protection, I would feel it. Oh, yeah. Back in verse, here it is again. Back in the same verse 15. He says in the beginning, I am with you and connection, right, will watch over you. That's protection. I'm going to watch over you because I'm going to make sure nobody's going to harm you. I'm going to watch over you to make sure that you're protected. I'm going to watch over you. Listen, there's not a parent. I understand that there's a term that are called helicopter parents. Well, it used to be called helicopter parents. Amen. Now they just call them drone parents because the helicopter can't get that close. Preach, Randall. I'm trying. Yeah, you know what? Listen to me. I understand we got to let them grow, But as a parent, you never stop being a parent. You never stop being protective. You never stop wanting to just stand in the gap in between you and your baby. Amen. Baby bigger than you, baby taller than you, but you still want to stand in the gap because I'm the parent. Well, where do you think you get that from? The ultimate parent, God Almighty. He told Jacob, I know you messed up. How many times you might have had to go down to the school? Amen. No baby done messed up. Yeah, listen, y'all ain't going to mistreat him. Y'all ain't gonna mistreat them. When I get them home, I'm gonna deal with them, but I'm still gonna protect them from you all harming them. Preach, Randall, I'm trying. What God says as the ultimate parent is, I am going to protect you. Even when you messed up, I don't condone it. Your consequences are still gonna come, but I'm gonna still protect you in it because I know what I have promised you and I'm gonna bring it to pass. I can't bring it to pass. Listen to what God says. I cannot bring it to pass if I don't protect you. Right? He promised Jacob where he was laying. Was going to be there. But Jacob wasn't going to stay there. Jacob was going to have to leave and go deal with some stuff. But God still said, I'm going to be with you. And I'm going to protect you. And you're going to feel my protection. Let me show you how he did it just quickly. When Laban tried to cheat him before he was coming back, he protected him. When he worked, when Laban tricked him, because when he saw Rachel, right? He said, listen, I'll work for her. But when it became that it was not the 7 years that agreed upon, but it was 14 years, God still protected him to be able to complete that. Everything God promised, because Rachel was tied to the promise, right? See, again, because how else was Joseph going to get there? Preach, Randall, I'm trying. Here it is. But they were tied to the promise, but God had to protect him. So what God is saying is, I know. God said, I'm the original helicopter drone parent. That's right, because when I promised to look after you, when I promise to watch over you, when I promise to protect you. God said, because I have qualities that you human parents don't have. You can't be omnipresent. He said, but I can. And because I can, amen. You ain't got to call me a drone parent. Just call me a divine parent. Hey, yes. See, here's what I want you to understand. Because God is going to protect his will. He's going to protect his promises for you. And therefore, that's why God says you're going to feel my presence. Because you're going to know I'm there. Because I'm going to be there to watch over you and protect you. And the thing about it, when Laban tried to rob him, he said, God showed me in a dream. The same way God communicated to him here before he got there. What Laban was trying to do. And God spoke to Laban in a dream. And made him back up off of Jacob because of what God had promised. God will speak to your enemies in a dream, whether they are believer or not, because he's God. You better back up off my child. Amen. That's not what you want to do. That's the kind of protective parent that he is. Amen. I ain't going to even get into some of y'all that probably had to have some side conversations with somebody trying to bully your child. They look here. Okay. Amen. Say, preach, boy. Number three, on your journey to what God promised you, stay ready to experience not only God's presence to know it, not only God's protection to feel it, but God's power to see it. Show it to me in the scripture. Preacher, here it is. He says, I'm with you and will watch over you, right? So we see presence, we see protection, but here is the power. Wherever you go. Yeah, wherever you go. Oh, wait a minute. What we see is, we see now, amen, the omnipotence of God found in God's omnipresence, right? Yeah, oh yeah, make no mistake about it. What God says is, on this journey, I can promise you that my member, that during her journey, she felt his presence, she felt his protection, she felt his power. You have done that in this year of increase by way of decrease. We felt God's presence without a doubt on the virtual and the in-person service, on the prayer call and on men's ministry, women's ministry, in the mission piece. We felt his presence. We've known his protection because God has kept and sustained us as a church entity. And the power we've seen it at work. And guess what? The best is yet to come, for eyes have not seen. Ears have not heard, neither has it entered into the heart of man, the things that God has prepared for them that love him. And we love God here, Spirit of God, Christian Church. We're going to see his power, but Jacob was going to see his power, because what God says is, not only will you know my presence, not only will you receive my protection, but you're going to see my power, because guess what? Everywhere you go, you're going to walk in blessings. Even in the midst of your consequences, you're going to still walk in blessings. Everywhere he went, when Jacob went, the cattle produced greater. So that when Laban said, take what you got, he was able to take the best because the power of the omniscient God, the omnipotent God was with him. The omnipresent God was with him. And he saw it. He recognized it. On your journey, I want you to know you're going to see God's power. God's going to do things that only he could do. God's going to make ways for you in the wilderness. Amen. Straight paths for you in the desert. God's going to do what he's supposed to do for you by his mighty hand. His power will bring forth his favor. His power will bring forth all that God has promised you. You're going to know it. And you'll feel it. You'll see his power at work. When he turns the heart, the king's heart is in the hand of the Lord, and as the rivers of water, he turns it whichever way he wishes. People who are bent on evil against you, God's going to turn around for good. Amen. You got to stay ready for what God has promised you, and you'll watch and see his power. Listen, I'm going to tell you why. This is a beautiful thing, because God will make sure that in the moment when he says yes, in the moment where he says now is the time, in the moment where you're no longer the backup, but now you got to go in and play in the game, and you've told him, put me in, coach, you're ready because you've been in his presence. You're ready because he's protected you. You're ready because his power is with me. So when I go in, I'm going to represent him with kingdom quality and kingdom excellence. And because I'm in his will, amen, amen, I'm going to see his power of provision. Amen. To pay that bill. Amen. Here it is. And then on your journey to what God promised you, stay ready to experience God's presence, to know it, his protection, to feel it, his power to see it, but his preservation to keep you. Oh, You'll got to see this with Jacob, because here is really where the rubber meets the road in the promise that he made Jacob. Me the team, let's go back to 28:15. He says, I'm with you, that's presence. I watch over you, that's protection. Wherever you go, very seriously, that is God's power. But also, he says, and I will bring you back to this land. Oh, and I will not leave you. Now, again, we know his presence was there, but I will bring you back to this land. Let me tell you why that is so big as far as preservation is concerned. In order to bring you back, that means then God says, I'm promising you that when you leave, that when I bring you back for what I have promised, that not only are you going to be able to leave, my presence is going to be with you, my protection is going to be there, and I'm going to exercise my power because I promised you I would preserve you, I'd keep you, so you can make it back. Oh, that's the real promise, because Jacob went through some stuff with Laban. Oh, yeah, with Laban's sons. He went with Rachel's brothers. He went through some stuff. Yeah, some of it he brought upon himself. But guess what? God said, I'm going to keep, as the old saying say, he'll keep you if you want to be kept. But here's the thing about this. God was going to keep Jacob, whether Jacob wanted to be kept or not, because God's name was on it and God's promise was there. On the days, I'm sure Jacob felt like he wanted to die. On the days he might have wanted to give up and give in, but God kept him. Let me tell you something. I had a member tell me when they lost a loved one who was so near and dear that I pray that nobody ever goes in and experience in the losing of a child. But that has been a great testimony for them, and they have shared that. They've glorified God in it. But one of the things he said was that he said that when he hit, and I didn't know him at the time, but I just heard him talk about it in the afterwards. He said, you know, I just would get up and put one foot in front of the other, that the Lord kept him in a time that I can promise you that in the brokenness of him and his wife and his son having lost a child, that I promise you that there were times when he just felt like giving up and giving in. But God said, I promised you what I was going to do for you. And he's doing it in his life big. I just need for you to understand that on your journey, even as you're waiting on God to do what he's promised you, God has kept you. See, you know, remember I was sharing you about that I saw in real time this week. The beauty was that God kept her on that job with that company, that God preserved until God was able to do what he's done. Let me say this here. God has kept us. God has made us recognize and realize the value of the land that he gave to us in a pandemic. At times when I said, listen, trying to build from the ground up in the city of Alpharetta is an absolute nightmare, and it very well may cost me my life or put me on death's door. And there were times I said, look, we can just sell this land and just go find a building that's already built and try to renovate it. But God said, but the blessing is the blessing, and the promise is the promise. And I've kept you. I've surrounded you. Thank God for every one of you. Surrounded you with members who understand my vision for this house. And I'm telling you, just seeing your smiling faces sometimes, hearing your words of encouragement and support are things that God has used as his preservation process to keep me when I didn't want to be kept. But because he promised that was the place he was going to build his house, in Alpharetta, Roswell, on 1200 Upper Henry Road, I know that God is going to bring us. When we stood on that land, Susan Jeffrey said, there's nothing but peace here. I remember hearing, and God was telling us, this is the place, because he made it happen, and we felt his power and how he did it in the time of a famine, if you will. God brought it back. But the thing he promised, I said, he told Jacob, he said, look, and I will bring you back to this land. Oh, isn't that a beautiful thing? That even though, Jacob, you're going to have to leave and go through some stuff, I'm going to bring you back. In other words, I'm going to keep you. I'm going to preserve you. I'm going to maintain you and sustain you. That what God has said, many of us, and I know that's a word right now, because many of you are taking steps of faith. You're seeking God for clarity. What God says is, if you get in my will, I promise you it's my bill. And because it's my bill, I'm going to keep you. I'm going to maintain you, and I'm going to sustain you. Can I just say a little bit here, fear to God? One of the things I love about what God has done with us, starting out as a church, as a startup, being the founding pastor and all of that. But what God has done is he's maintained and sustained us. We saw an economic downturn in 2008. We saw a pandemic come in 2020. We've seen ups and downs. We've seen members come and go. But God himself, who is our source, has maintained and sustained us. He's preserved us. Amen. For what he promised us. That's why I'm encouraged today. The smile on my face is because I can go through my mind's eye and look at what God has done. And it's been marvelous in my eyes because he has kept us. Amen. Because we wanted to be kept by him. But he kept us even on days when we just wanted to throw our hands up and say, God, that's enough. And God said, no, but I've maintained and sustained you. Your shoes haven't worn out. Your clothes haven't worn out. Not one bill of Spirit of God Christian Church has not been paid on time. He said, because I maintained and sustained you, because I kept you because of what I promised. And God says, I'm going to do it for the people of Spirit of God as well. Then last one, y'all, on your journey to what God promised you. Stay ready to experience God's presence, his protection, his power, his preservation, but his promise. We're going to experience his promise. In other words, that God's going to fulfill it. Because that which God says shall be and shall come to pass. Show it to me in 15 again. Here it is. I am with you, right? Presence will watch over you, protection. Wherever you go, that's God's power. And I will bring you back to this land, preservation. That way, when you go out, I promise you, you're coming back. And then I will not leave you until I've done. And see, I like this, what I have promised. Because I see what God says, what I have promised. Amen. God said, because see, until I've done it, till I fulfilled it, until I've done it and brought it to completion. God said, I'm not going to leave you. I'm going to make sure I do it. And that's why he could tell Jacob that the land you're lying on right now is we're having this dialogue. I'm going to give to you and your descendants, and all of the generations of the earth are going to be blessed through your people, because I made that promise to Abraham. I made it to Isaac, and now I'm making it to you. And how many know that Jacob came back and God fulfilled every promise that he made to him? That God, what God says is he will fulfill it and he will bring it to pass. I just need for you to stay the course, stay in God's will and watch him pay this bill. Stay on the journey God has you on. Continue to operate in kingdom quality. Continue to operate in kingdom excellence. Continue to do what the Lord has. Continue to be faithful in your prayer time. Continue to be faithful in his word. Continue to seek his presence. Continue to sing songs of praise. And watch what God does on the journey. Continue to take the steps on the path he has you on. Trust in the Lord on thine heart and lean not to thine own understanding. In all thy ways acknowledge him. And he'll direct your path, the path God has you on, the one he promised you. You need to stay on that. Stay in his will and know that he'll pick up the bill on that. Understand that what he promised, stay ready for what God has promised, so that when God says it quickly, you're ready to go. Amen. Amen. You got to be getting ready. No. I'm ready to go, God. I was prepared, God. When I said, put me in, coach, and you came and tapped me on the shoulder, I had a helmet in hand. I was ready to go. I was already loose and stretched. I was ready, God, that when you put me in the game, there was no drop off from the starter to me. Preach, Randall. I'm trying, Lord. But here it is. I'm going to give you this note, media team. Put this up for me. Here's what's required for your journey. Just one thing I need for you to understand. Patient faith. You have to have it. I know God has promised you're going to know his presence. You're going to feel his protection. You're going to see his power. He's going to keep you by preserving you. And he's going to fulfill his promise. But we all, I'm a living witness, have had to have patient faith. God, I'm going to wait on you. I'll wait on you. Yes, I'll wait on you. I ain't waiting on nobody else, but I'll wait on you because you are I am. And I am promised to be with me. I am promised. What? To watch over me. I am promised to be with me wherever I go. I am promised to bring me to the land that he promised. I am promised me that he would never leave me or forsake me. He promised me he'd provide. He promised me every day wouldn't be good, but all things would work out for my good. He promised to go ahead of me. He promised that others would be blessed. And I'm just telling you, he did this with Jacob, a sinner just like you and me, right? Whose name meant supplanter. His name meant trickster, if you will. God said, but I promised. And I'm going to fulfill the promises I made. So you stay ready for what God has promised you. And I thank God for all of the testimonies around that have helped me and helped me, allowed me to continue to go forward. And I thank God for you for keeping us in that place. Make no mistake, on this journey you're on, I want you to know that you're going to be able to walk in God's presence, His protection, His power, His perseverance, His perseverance, and in His promise, it will be fulfilled. Amen. Amen. And amen. Let's pray. Father, we give you thanks for this day. We bless and praise your holy and righteous name. Father, we thank you for this reminder that you won't leave us until you have done all that you have promised on this journey. Father, so many promises you've made. We thank you, God, for honoring the promise, because you're that kind of God that even if you didn't promise us, you promised mama, promised daddy, grandmama, and granddad. You promised our prayer partners, our brothers and sisters in Christ. You promised our siblings, God. You promised those who prayed to you about us. But then, Lord, we had our own encounter, and that you made that promise, God, that you confirmed that promise. So, Lord, we walk in it. God, we know what you promised Spirit of God Christian Church, that we would impact this world for the name of Jesus Christ to the glory of God, that God, you would be glorified in Spirit of God Christian Church, and your people would be forever edified. We pray, God, that whatever it takes to do it, God, that you bring it to pass. We trust you. We thank you, God, for allowing us on this journey, these 19 and a half years, to know your presence, to feel your protection and see your power, for you keeping us and preserving us, God, when many churches at different times that started out with us have closed down and are no more, but you kept us. We thank you. But God, we know that you shall fulfill the promise. And in it, God, we will give you glory. Thank you, God, for giving us the strength to have patient faith, knowing that we had to have it for this journey. We thank you, God, that when our faith, our patient faith ran low, you filled us up. And God, we just bless your name. We pray now, God, for the membership, those who hear this message, whatever it is that they're going through, whatever journey you have them on, God, that they will know your presence, your power, God, your protection. Preserve them, Lord, and fulfill your promise in their lives, Lord. Let this message encourage and inspire your people to know that truly the best is ahead of them, and that you promise to bring them back to that land. God, you promise to bring them back to keep us to what you promised. Father, we thank you in advance. We praise you in advance for that which you promised, as it shall come to pass. Now, Lord, if there's any out here who hear this message and desire to give their lives over to Jesus Christ, receive them just as they come, sincerely and genuinely, making the confession out of the belief in their heart that Jesus is the Christ, who lived a sinless life, died on the cross for them, and rose that third day morning with all power in his hand. God, we thank you and we bless you. Father, bless this church, bless this message. And God, we pray that you are glorified today, and God, that your people are edified. And God, we do say to you, Lord, that we are yours, put us in, and bring to pass that which you promise. In Jesus' name it is that we pray. Amen and amen. I'm Pastor Randall Knighton, pastor of Spirit of God Christian Church. Stay ready for what God promised, and stay in his will, for God's will certainly is his bill. God promised it. It shall come to pass. God bless you, and God keep you is our prayer.
Wow, what a great service and message from the Lord. We thank you for tuning in and pray that you were blessed by today's service. Remember to invite others to join each week so they can be blessed too. Please continue to support the ministry and download the Spirit of God Christian Church app, if you haven't already, so that you can stay informed on all things Spirit of God. As always, our online giving options are available on the church's app, website, and Cash App. Remember, we're in a year of increase by way of decrease. Let's decrease more of self so that Christ may increase in us. Have a blessed week, and we'll see you soon.